Copper lane time. Oh, we're almost at the dormitory. Answer us about
Hail, traveler.
I'm looking for Vianna. Corin sways slightly from side to side. Your skin's still green, but you've lost your ducks. I like Vianna. She's always talking about metal men, which is strange, since I'm pretty sure she doesn't eat snowcap. His brow wrinkles. I don't talk about metal men either, and I do eat snowcap. Anyway, she's not here right now. Flew away to Andra's gift to meet her friend, Bessia. No, Klesia. Yes, Klesia. Klesia is the friend she's gone to meet, in Andra's gift. In a house, not a boat. North house. Empty house. Andra's house. Andra's gift has a lot of boats. We should go rowing sometime. Right. Alright, so we have to go to that other district anyway. So we still have time. Oh. Let's talk to, Edir.
Strange place for a shrine to Abidan, Crucible Keep. Maybe it made more sense at some point before it gathered all that dust. And the only thing the Knights of the Crucible worship these days is the nobility, as far as I understand it.
I knew some soldiers who got recruited by the Knights after the war was over. They told me some about it. They get these young kids in there and they tell them about the blacksmithing and about the revolution and about tradition. Talk about the golem like he created the Crucible Knights in his forge to go win Deerwood's independence. Then they join, and it turns out all any of these knights ever talks about is when are we going to get recognized as a real knighthood? When are we getting our titles and our land? Their High Justice wants to be an earl. Says it's Abaddon's will. He's got a castle and an army. You wonder how long he'll wait before he starts a war over it, saying Abaddon told him so. And the nobles will respond that their gods told them that they're the only true nobles. Trouble with having all these gods if you got a support no matter... You've got support no matter how dumb your ideas are. Maybe we had the right idea blowing some of them up. Less of them to hide behind. Okay, moving on. Alright. So, Ondra's gift, Heritage Hill, not ready for that yet. Zombies. Let's go to Brackenbury. We need to go there to find out what's going on. Help that guy from the dozens. What's his name? Us. Something. Something or other. Osric. I really don't like that dude. That, That guy. See, I can't remember names, that's why it's good. And we have this. Penhelm, yeah, so I'm kind of eager, you know, personally, to prove some kind of, his document was forged and he's really not a pure deerwood soul or whatever the hell. A local lad is reported missing. Those with information as to the location of the boy, etc. Something about someone in Andra's gift. Brackenbury. Well, I got to get a look at a little bit of this, but... Wait. No, it's this way. It's down here. Boop. Brackenbury. Ta-da. Duty and spirit. Well, there's animancers here. Nedin. He says dot dot dot. Business around here took a hit when Stalwart's mines dried up. Nedin, someone we can talk to, or someone we can look at history. The woman is absorbed in a book, muttering softly as she reads.
Hail and well met.
I like that voice. A woman stands in the shade of the garden, muttering to herself. She's fixated on the pages of a large and well-worn tome, seemingly oblivious to the blooming flowers and the cool, fragrant breeze. She only looks up when your shadow crosses her page. Do you mind? I'm rather busy. What are you so busy with? She snaps her book shut. I'm studying soul attachment. We all know that souls move into people at birth and out of them at death, but we still have a lot of questions about what makes them stick, so to speak. New theme. What do you mean about making them stick? She brushes a stray lock from her forehead. Souls power bodies and give their tissues life, but only when they're firmly attached. It's separation that leads to a whole spate of soul-related ailments, including the Hollowborn. But if we understood how to reattach souls, we could end Widewind's legacy, maybe even conquer death. She scratches behind her ear. That's a theory, anyway. Unfortunately, I don't have all the research I need to put it into practice. What exactly do you need? There's a manuscript called The Theorems of Pandgram. It contains research from Pangram's experiments on detached souls. The Hall of Revealed Mysteries is rumored to have a copy in the Elder Archives. Cool. I've been there. Kanna says, Pangram's work is considered to be one of the more, daring animancy texts. Not something generally circulated among novices, nor easy to get a hold of. I wonder if we might have a peek at it. The theorems could advance my research by leaps and bounds, but Grimda, the High Archivist, worships Whale, which means she has some paradoxical views on sharing and restricting knowledge. And since she's not exactly a proponent of animancy, she tends to restrict the kinds of information that would be useful to me. Maybe she could be persuaded. You're welcome to try, but you wouldn't be the first. Look at me spilling my troubles. It's kind of you to listen, but I should really get back to my work. Anything else? She looks eager to return to her studies. Tell me about yourself. I'm an animancer at the sanitarium. Currently, I'm researching matters related to Widewind's legacy. What's Widewind's legacy? I know, Hollowborn. Widewind's legacy refers to the rise in Hollowborn children in the Deerwood in recent years. Some have also connected it to so-called Beowicks that blow through Ir Glanfath. There's hardly any reliable data on those, though, so I can't really comment. She sniffs. I don't much care for the term Widewind's legacy. It reeks of superstition, but it's too prevalent to change at this point. Personally, I'd like to see people take a more methodical approach to these matters, rather than throwing up their hands and blaming the gods. Edir says. Don't think their woodens would see much too much fun in that. I have some questions about the theorems of Pangram. Such as?
Tell me about them.
Pangram was an animancer working in the Deerwood. He had some interesting theories about essence and some rather innovative techniques for studying it. He was able to reattach souls to bodies after death, though he wasn't able to prevent his patients from degenerating. He was controversial, to say the least, but many are starting to realize that he was merely ahead of his time. What do you mean by degenerating? Nedwyn twists her hands together. Well, there seems to be a tiny problem with reattaching souls after death. The bodies will reanimate and may even retain memories and personality, but they develop a hunger for flesh, living, soul-infused flesh. Without it, they start to devolve, decaying mentally and physically. If the process goes too far, which it eventually does, they become mindless corpses, attacking anything that moves. We haven't figured out a way to avoid that. Yeah, I've seen that. So actually, they devolve into zombies. Living zombies. Kanna says, that is more than an inconvenient side effect. You've reproduced an unnatural curse with little to show for it. That sounds like necromancy. Nonsense. Necromancy is magic. This is science. She emphasizes the last word. Why doesn't Grimta lend you the books you need? The Hall of Revealed Mysteries is rather protective of its books, especially the rarer ones, and Grimta in particular. She hates animancy, thinks it's dangerous. I don't see how you can run the greatest library in the Deerwood and be so averse to the spread of knowledge and research, but I've never understood these religious types. Ayla scowls at the animancer. Some knowledge is best kept under lock and key. Tell me about the Hall of Revealed Mysteries. You'll find it in the Copper Lane District. It's dedicated to the God of Secrets and Revelations. More importantly, it houses the largest and most expensive library in the Deerwood. Kanna says, well, that settles it. We simply must go see it, right? Kanna, we've been there already. Just wanted to know what she'd say. What are the Elder Archives? The Elder Archives hold the rarest, most arcane, and most powerful texts in the Deerwood. Think of it as the inner sanctum of the Hall of Revealed Mysteries. Needless to say, you need Grimda's permission to enter. That's all I wanted to ask. I don't see how she's going to let us in. These charming windows are reinforced with iron bars and a double thickness of glass. Let's take a look at the map of this place. Oh, it's rather thin, isn't it? That goes to Ondra's gift. We're in front of the sanitarium. There's also, oh, there's House Dominel. Raymont Manor. The Charred Barrel. And it goes right to Copper Lane. Cool. Alright, let's look around. Just hear me out. This procedure, her soul would be returned intact. More or less. More or less? Is that how you plan on presenting your idea to Ethelmower? Why? Not good? Not good. Sanitarium. Animancers. Speak with Head Warden Ethelmower if you wish to make an appointment with one of our animancers. Welcome to the finest animancy center in the Deerwood. Alright. Oh, there's more. There's another. Or is that the same? Probably has the same description. Yep. Zoom out just a little bit so I can see more. See more in one shot here. There's Peoples. The marble is cool and perfectly smooth. Droplets of crystal clear water bead the statues. Well, that's Hadrit House. I didn't notice that one. Lyra Rassan. I know the history. You see a woman, dark-skinned, taut with worry. Moving aft, she scales the rigging and shouts frantically at the crew. The ship isn't turning fast enough. She looks at the captain, gaping soundlessly at the approaching vessel. Her hands blister from the descent as she jumps from rope to rope, screaming at him to take action, take charge, do something. What is she paying him for if not to defend her ship from pirates? With a squeal as ladders are thrown across, the ship is boarded. She sprints below decks, taking the steps three at a time until she reaches the cargo hold. Scrabbling amongst the containers, she searches until she finds it, a blunderbuss, fully loaded. Someone grabs her from behind. She throws up a knee, whirls around, and shoots. The force sends her spine first into the wall, but her assailant falls to the ground with half a head and without an arm. Dragging herself up the stairs, she reloads and engages the enemy force with her crew. She cocks an eyebrow as pirates drop left and right. Clearly this was more than they bargained for when they chose her ship. Interesting. Excuse me. Business around here took a hit. Yeah, the mines.
Hey. All right, then.
Everybody. The Charred Barrel is the finest inn in the city if you're looking for lodging. Despite what you may have heard, nothing unusual goes on at the sanitarium. No, I'm sure. There isn't so much as a spot on these oranges. I don't need that. Especially with these guys that will report me for stealing sugar. Okay, there's a couple ways up these, some kind of interesting stairs here. Ark of the Gath. Oh, come on, with a name like that, we can't talk to him. You see a rocky clearing, overgrown with weeds. A crumbling wall cuts through on one side, and the trees reach toward each other overhead, blocking much of the light that would otherwise illuminate the body lying near the wall. The body belongs to an elf, face down in the dirt. His clothes are torn and ragged. Large bruises seem to cover him, and there are cuts, abrasions, and lacerations everywhere. Skin is exposed to the air. The elf twitches, a muffled cry escaping his lips, blushing dust around his head. He begins to moan, his hands scrabbling against the ground, fending off something you are unable to see. His breath comes faster and faster until he is almost hyperventilating. With one final sound, a swallowed scream, his eyes fly open. In an instant he is on his feet, crouching, eyes wildly looking around. His breathing doesn't slow, and every exhalation is a groan. With one last look over his shoulder, the elf runs into the embrace of the crumbling wall shadow, all but disappearing into the gloom. Looking down at his present condition, he murmurs, "I don't see how anyone who so clearly screws his own livestock can be so sensitive about it." That's weird. Part of himself, like his soul or something, detached and ran off? I don't know. It's almost like he's looking down at himself and talking about himself. I don't know. And these stairs lead that way, okay. That's House Dominel. How do I get to these people? Oh, up the other stairs. There's only gonna be more histories. Some nobles over here. We're very lucky to have Dunreed Row based in Brackenbury. It makes the district feel safer. House Dominel has a dark reputation, but they're perfectly good neighbors. The sooner Lord Raymond commits his crazy daughter to the sanitarium, the better. That's not nice. Oh look, Adra. Pillars. Of eternity. Rocco Francis Whitebrows. Got a short one. You see a burly man inspecting a dilapidated inn, the Omawa salesman almost dwarfing him as they walk through the once proud establishment. The walls are rife with stains, and only Whale knows what else smeared on every available surface. Not one thing stands unbroken, and moth-eaten blankets, rotting food, and trash give evidence to a succession of squatters. The man frowns, scrutinizing the space. The Omawa gives him a final offer, flashing two white teeth with each syllable, oversized and threatening. With a sigh and a jingle as he hands over the coin pouch, the man acquires the dump of an inn and begins to plan. Hopefully he improved it. Timothy Whitewater? You see this man kneeling naked before a dais in the center of a large, round room. Across the room, opposite from where he kneels, stands a large throne. The throne's back and two of its legs are broken, rendering it unusable and causing it to tilt precariously on its stand. The room is ringed with figures clad in black robes, each chanting quietly, resulting in a low drone that pervades the room. On the dais, across the brazier, is another robed figure holding a leather-bound book with charred marks on it. He is speaking to the naked man about fealty, dedication, and law. When he finishes, he bids the other to rise and holds the book out to him over the burning coals in the brazier. The naked man nods, and the robed man drops the book into the fire. The naked man drops to one knee, briefly pressing his forehead to the side of the brazier, then stands and thrusts both of his hands into the coals at the bottom of the brazier. He retrieves the book, slowly presenting it to the robed figure before him. The man rubs his thumb on the ash that is collected on the cover of the book and uses it to draw a mark on the naked man's forehead over the burned flesh. The naked man bows his head and whispers, "Was that right, Da?" The robed man nods patiently. The naked man looks to the broken throne with childlike eyes. "Did you see that, Mum?" Righto. Too many stories. Jalistra the Palzerker Stobar. You see a dark room. Noise filters in through a nearby doorway. The sounds of battle, scuffling, metal on metal, cries of pain rise and fall as a fight rages on outside. There's a bellow of rage and a Zorup runs into the room, holding a book tightly against its chest. It looks around frantically, searching for something. It hurries to the far side of the room and opens a box sitting on a makeshift table. It places the book in the box, closes it, and then bends over to push the box under the table. A small stone hits the back of the Zorup's head, knocking it forward a little. The stone bouncing to the ground, rattling a little as it comes to the... The stone bounces to the ground, rattling a little as it comes to rest on the floor next to the Zorup's foot. It freezes in place, hands still on the box, eyes wide. As the clattering of the stone quiets, silence takes control of the room again. The battle outside has stopped. It spins around to find this woman standing in the doorway, leaning on a savage-looking two-handed sword. "That book contains the answers I need," she snarls at it, moving forward. It hisses, rushing to meet her. Seconds later, she is retrieving the stone from the floor, having separated its head from its neck with a practiced flick of the sword. She smiles, kisses the stone, and then places it in a pouch on her belt, patting it fondly. Leaning over, she pulls the box from under the table and opens it, elated with her find. And Isabel. You see a lush forest, quiet and dark in the early morning light. This woman walks through the trees, a captivated look on her face. She doesn't appear to have a particular destination in mind as she wanders slowly between the enormous trunks, looking up through the branches and occasionally making a low chirping sound. when a responding chirp echoes through the quiet morning. She turns to head in that direction, obviously not concerned with losing her way. A loud metallic snap, followed by a quick yelp, cuts through the air, and she looks to it, focusing in the direction from which the sound came. She moves toward it on the verge of running. She seems to realize suddenly that caution is important and freezes, looking down, her foot hovering over the pressure plate on a well-hidden bear trap. She leans back and gingerly places her foot back on the ground next to the trap. She looks around, anger darkening her features. Grabbing a nearby branch, she presses down on the plate and disables the trap. When it snaps shut, she hears another yelp, this time much closer. Scanning the ground for more traps, she carefully makes her way towards the trapped animal. Rounding one of the trees, she spies him, a large wolf, bony with malnourishment, right hind leg held tight in the rusty metal teeth. He looks at her, and a low growl starts in the back of his throat. His hackles rise, and she pauses briefly to let him catch her scent. She lowers herself closer to the ground and holds her hands out, palm down, in front of her. "Aren't you a beautiful boy?" She inches toward the wolf. Okay. Continuing. Nobles. The charred barrel. I'm just finished looking around outside, guys, and then we'll call it an episode. Ooh, it's up there. Huh. The mortared stone wall is sheltered by the leaves. Or the eaves? Yeah, sheltered by the eaves. A knotty green vine climbs all the way up to an open window. Two ornate shutters seem to beckon you in. Test the vines. You give the vines a shake. They're thick and sturdy in your hands, but near the top they look flimsier. You might be able to make it to the top if you're quick. We're not doing that yet. I guess we'll need to find a back way into this place. What is this? Raymont Manor. Interesting. Good day to you. Lord Gatterman, I never would have believed it. Believe what? Okay. Guess that's it for this place. Another noble. Did we talk to them? Yeah. Okay, we're probably gonna check out the charred barrel next. As far as this place, Raymont Manor, I see no need to climb in the window since we can go in the front door, but there's probably gonna be a reason to do that, so first we'll obviously go through the front door. Anyway, thanks for watching. See you in the next episode, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.